Welcome to the Heavy Spoilers Show. I'm your host Definition, aka the slowest gun in the West. In this episode, we're breaking down the premiere of Westworld Season 3. This episode feels like a soft reboot in many ways, with us getting a new aesthetic for the show, as well as some brand new faces. Throughout this video, we're going to be breaking down the new entry, discussing our theories on what's going on, and where the season could be going in the future. There will be heavy spoilers here, so if you don't want anything ruined, then I highly recommend that you turn off now. Make sure you subscribe to the channel, as we'll be breaking down the entire season, and please drop a thumbs up if you enjoy the video. Anyway, with all that out of the way, thank you for clicking this. Now let's get into our breakdown of Westworld Season 3. Okay, so the episode titled Passe Domine actually comes from the Bible. In Joel 2:17, we can find the phrase which translates to, "Spare Lord, spare your people, be not angry with us forever." This kinda has a sway over the entire episode, with there being a motif of gods and forgiveness. Things have changed a lot since last time, and Delos is no longer the company that it was. Delos' stock has completely plummeted in the wake of the Westworld massacre, and the shareholders, as you can guess, aren't very happy. On a tablet with the story, we can see that 75 were killed and 200 were injured, making it one of the biggest death tolls since Jurassic World. But still, that had two parks, so yeah, don't worry too much, Delos. Now we see all of this through the eyes of Jerry, an ex-Insight employee who tries to recoup his stock before being attacked in his own home. The machines have turned on him, and the smart home that he once relied on so heavily is now fighting back. I love this introduction, and it felt very much like an episode of Black Mirror in which your Alexa turns bad. Again, this sort of plays into the title of the episode, as Jerry begs to get forgiveness from a sentient AI god. Jerry has become completely reliant on technology, and whilst he thought he commanded it, it was actually the other way around. Sleeping gas has been unleashed in the home, and Jerry has been locked in. There's a brilliant callback to 2001, with his AI system giving an almost HAL-like response of, "I'm afraid I can't do that," when he tries to exit the property. This has all been set up by Dolores in order to enact revenge, and we are reintroduced to her swimming naked in Jerry's pool. It's revealed that Jerry was a guest at Westworld, and that he sexually assaulted her during a visit to the park. Using the code collected by Delos, Dolores has overseen his algorithm, and she makes him come face to face with the monster that he really is. It turns out that Jerry severely beat his prior wife, and it is possible that he killed her. He stated that he would change when he remarried, but he ended up doing the same things to his new love. This shows that, like the hosts, people themselves are stuck in loops, and that we also exist in routines that are based off our nature. Jerry seems very remorseful, but in order to be truly sorry, we must show this through our actions. He shows that he is truly trapped by his nature, as he attempts to attack Dolores as she leaves. This version of her turns out to be a hologram, and Jerry falls and cracks his head on the swimming pool in attempting to batter her. Jerry's wife awakens and asks who Dolores is, and she says, "The person who set you free." Now why this is interesting is because Dolores last time was pretty much against all of humanity. However, she now realizes that the hosts and lower parts of civilization all have something in common with one another. Similar to Dolores, Jerry's wife was used and abused at the hands of her husband, and she was stuck in a loop much like the hosts. This intro sets up the motif that Dolores will be helping to free the poor and vulnerable, much in the same way that she helped to free the hosts. It's an awesome opening that really sets things up as we head into the titles. From here we jump to LA, where an anomaly has been detected. We join Caleb, played by Aaron Paul, who is going through some tough times. His mother doesn't acknowledge him, he runs fiber on top of several other jobs, and gets therapy from an AI version of his friend Francis, who we learn died when the two were together in the army. This system has been designed to keep him in line, but in the end it ends up breaking him because it differs so much from the real Francis. It's a really interesting aesthetic that shows we can only gain true happiness from forging real relationships, and things like social media, where we present fake versions of ourselves, aren't the route that we should travel. Caleb is a really interesting character who feels like he has little to no purpose due to the fact that machines can do his entire skill set either at the same level or better than he can. What this opening episode does is that it shows how far machines have advanced beyond humans and how we are now useless in comparison. We have truly created the thing that will destroy us, and there are similarities between this and the ancient Greek myths of old, with Kronos creating Zeus who would eventually upheave him. What else is fascinating about Caleb's story is that you really get a clear depiction of the class divide. In season 1, Dolores Dolores only saw the rich acting on their worst impulses, and thus she formed the opinion that everyone was like that. In contrast to this, Caleb and people like him are far too poor to afford a trip to the park, and they share many similarities with the hosts. They have jobs and routines that they must carry out, have little choice in what they can do, and are stepped on by the rich who live in luxury. Caleb has the option to turn on an implant that will mentally handicap him and make the mundanity of his life that much easier to get through, but he refuses. To me, this mirrors the memory wipes that the hosts were subjected to in the first season. Those were in place to make it easier to live through what they were subjected to in the park, and the fact that Caleb turns this down shows that he is breaking out of his loop. Another interesting character is Caleb's robot companion George, who does most of the heavy lifting on their job. I think when Dolores properly meets the pair, she will realize that she has more in common with Caleb rather than this other machine, and it's interesting that this is being set up here, showing that even in humanity there are several divides. There's an awesome nod to the famous image of the construction workers sitting having their lunch, and our intro to him is very well shot and put together, so it sets up exactly why he does what he does next. That is, crime. With an Uber-like app named Rico, Caleb picks up a job and joins a crew, carrying out an almost Grand Theft Auto-like heist. People are rated, selected for jobs, and recommended, and it's a fascinating plot device in this opener that I think will pop up down the line. Now, this reminded me a lot of the jobs that we saw in the first season of Westworld. Guests could choose their own quests, and their robbery is quite similar to the ones that the bandits carried out on Maven Co. in the first season. They stole a safe, Caleb steals an ATM, and having just rewatched the recent series back to back, I appreciated these little callbacks. Elsewhere, we join whichever host is in Charlotte Hale. She lands at Delos, and there's lip service paid to the fact that more than 75 died. It is likely that Delos is lying to the press so that their stocks don't plummet further. Who is in Hale's body, we don't know yet, but if you watch my trailer breakdown, then you'll know that the most likely option is Teddy. Though Teddy died in season 2, in an interview with James Marsden, when asked if the character was out for good, he stated, "I mean, I'm not allowed to say anything, but I would say that just based on your hypothesis, if he's died 4,000 times, then I would say that the odds are probably strong. Yeah, and you know, but it's a question I can't answer, and I think time will tell." So yeah, I think that we can guess that this is Teddy, and great poker face there, James. Well done covering that up. Hale wants to resume host production, possibly to build an army for the small group of pearls that are out there, and I think that many will be jumping into the body of Hale from time to time in order to carry out matters that crush the company. Working under the name Delgado, Bernard is lying low and doing his best impression of Thanos on a synthetic cow farm. He checks to see if anyone has tampered with his code, and he jumps back and forth between his diagnostics and himself. For me, this paranoia still hangs heavily over the character, as you may remember in season 2 that Vord invaded part of his psyche. Later in the episode, he's discovered by his co-workers, and he ends up having to take them down and going on the run. Cut back to Dolores, and we learn that she's now dating a high-ranking member of Insight named Liam Dempsey. Dempsey in some ways is very similar to William, aka the Man in Black, and he even has this arrogant idiot friend that just spouts loads of nonsense. On top of this, he has inherited Insight from his father and lives very much in his shadow. His father created a machine that was able to predict people's behaviors and therefore their future, and using this, the company charted a course for every single person on the planet. This machine was scattered throughout the title sequence, so we do know that it's gonna mean a lot going forward. Similar to Westworld, this machine has created loops and storylines that people must follow in order to serve the greater good, or rather the rich. If destroyed, it could destabilize the world and set everyone free from the trappings of their reality, so I think it will become a big target for Dolores. Now, what's interesting here is that there's lip service paid to everything being a simulation. We do know that Warworld will be in the show from the post-credit scene, however, at the moment, we have no idea what's happening with the other park site, Futureworld. Not to get all tinfoil hat, but it is possible that Caleb is actually a host, stuck in a loop, and we are currently in Future World. Caleb was introduced much in the same way that we were to Dolores in the very first episode. He wakes up, goes about his loop, goes back to bed, wakes up, rinse and repeat. At points he's interviewed much in the same way that Arnold interviewed Dolores, asked how he got there, and generally guided by external factors to following a path much in the same way that she was. So, this could all indeed be a simulation within a simulation, as stated, but I'll let you decide that in the comments section below. Later, when showing his father's legacy to Dolores, Dempsey is called away to an urgent matter and she tails him on a motorbike. It's awesome seeing just how much the character has evolved, and she's taken from horses to bikes and spy stuff really well. She gets a great F off line, and yeah, just amazing. Dempsey is feeling the pressure from those around him, and Dolores overhears a conversation about Delos, which sends her further down the rabbit hole. Dolores learns that Dempsey is just a figurehead, and that only a specific person has access to the system. When she starts inquiring further, she's knocked out by Dempsey's bodyguard, played by Tommy Flanagan. Legend. They discover that she planned to ambush Dempsey and escort her away to kill her. Here, her paths intersect with Caleb for the first time, who just so happens to be doing a Rico job. Dolores goes full dodge from Picard on them, and it's an incredible action scene. It's beautifully shot, with the rear cam showing the action behind the car, whilst the windscreen displays it in front. She chases after Flanagan, whilst Caleb breaks out of his loop, and there's a nice feeling of everything coming full circle. Similar to the opening of the episode, Dolores confronts Flanagan, divulging that he too assaulted her in the park. He gives up the name Sharrick and says that due to his system, he will find her before she finds him. She presents a replica of him that kills him and states that the real gods are coming and that they're very angry. This of course plays into the title, and we watch as Flanagan kills Flanagan. So what we can take from all this is that she now knows who is in control of the system and has a plan in Dempsey's organization. Which pearl is in Flanagan, we don't know yet, but it's nice that Dolores is getting the pieces in place to take down the Empire. After being heavily wounded, Caleb comes across her, and he's the first person to ask if she actually needs some help. It looks like the two are going to go off on their own little mission, similar to how William did with her in the first season. I just hope that Caleb gets a happier ending than he did. We then cut to Bernard, who has made his way back to the mainland, and is heading back to Westworld in search of a friend. Now, from next week's trailer, we learn that this is Maeve. Luke Hemsworth's character Ashley is also going to be returning, and it looks like he and Bernard will be teaming up to track her down. In the post-credits scene, we join Maeve in Warworld, similar to how she entered Shogun World, and she's clearly recruiting other hosts and trying to free them, but where this will lead, we don't know yet. It's very Casablanca-esque, and shows that there are similar parks operating in the area. Now, how she got there, we don't know. Hell, we don't even know if this is really Maeve at this point, and it looks like she's killed a German soldier and tied one up. Perhaps Maeve at this point has complete admin access and is able to jump from host to host at will, but it will be interesting to see what she does in this new area. Could she be liberating the city from their occupiers, similar to how the people were liberated in the Second World War? Personally, I think so, and next time it looks like we are focusing more on Hale and who she really is. From this, I really got indications that it was indeed Teddy in Hale's body, and it looks like we are going back to Westworld. Bernard seems to be wishing to stop Dolores, and he's gonna need Maeve to do this, and probably an army of German soldiers. Imagine that, that would cause some controversy. It's all ramping up to one big showdown, and I can't wait to see what happens next. This was an incredible first episode, and after it, I just got goosebumps thinking I'm so happy to see Westworld back. This is how you do a first episode, and everything from the effects to the pacing and just general aesthetic of the show has instantly elevated it to being one of the best things on TV so far this year. Obviously, I'd love to hear your thoughts on the episode and if you're as hyped as I am. I can't wait to see how things fall into place, and yeah, just a completely outstanding first episode. Now obviously, I'd love to hear your thoughts on the entry and what your theories are for the show going ahead. Comment below and let us know, and if you enjoyed this video then please drop a thumbs up, and make sure you check out our full breakdown of The Outsider, which is going to be linked at the end. Similar to Westworld, we went through the entire season, so it's definitely worth checking out if you caught the HBO show. If you want to support the channel from as little as 99 cents a month, then please click the join button below. We massively appreciate it, and as a thank you, you get access to content early. If you want to come chat to us after the show, either follow us at DefinitionYT or click the Discord link in the description below. Every month we give away free movies to people who are subscribed to the channel, and this month you can win the Star Wars Skywalker Saga box set, and all you have to do is comment on a video and make sure you subscribe with notifications on. The winner is going to be chosen at random on the 15th of April, and the set will be shipped out from then to whoever gets the prize, so best of luck to everyone who takes part. This is a channel for people who are never missing television, so if that's the kind of thing you like, you need to subscribe to Definition. Thanks again for taking the time to watch this, you've been the best, and I'll see you next time. Take care, peace.